Oh, this is Michael Scott, regional manager.
Well, this is William M. Buttlicker.
Hello, Mr. Buttlicker. How may we help you?
From BJ Novak being the first person to be cast to John Krasinski almost screwing up his audition, let's talk about The Office and things you didn't know about the cast members. When I think about the show now, I can't imagine someone else being cast in the classic roles of, say, Michael Scott or Jim Halpert. But that's exactly what could have happened. The cast could have been entirely different from what we've seen. For instance, can you imagine that Seth Rogen was actually in the running to play Dwight Schrute? Or that Adam Scott had auditioned for the role of Jim? Even Eric Stone Street, who landed a major character on the hilarious sitcom Modern Family, auditioned for the role of Kevin. Angela Kinsey auditioned for Pam's role before being cast as Angela. And Bob Odenkirk was in fact cast as Michael Scott. But thankfully, he was replaced by the legendary Steve Carell when the show he was working on was canceled. Interestingly, while all these auditions were going on, BJ Novak became the first person to be cast. Greg Daniels, the show's producer, saw Novak on Saturday Night Live and was totally impressed. He wanted to hire the entertainer as both a writer and performer for the show. Eventually, other writer-performers were added to the show, like Mindy Kaling as Kelly Kapoor, Paul Lieberstein as Toby, and Michael Schur, who both wrote and produced the show but was also featured as Dwight's cousin Moose. Now, a major reason for Adam Scott being easily able to play Jim Halpert is primarily because John Krasinski's audition didn't really go that well. Yep, he kinda screwed things up. First of all, he was technically supposed to audition for the role of Dwight, but he convinced casting directors to let him read for the part of Jim. Then he got in trouble while in the waiting room. A man in the waiting room asked Krasinski if he was feeling nervous. The actor launched into this whole dialogue about how Americans tend to screw up opportunities like these. You know, the ones where they're adapting British shows for American audiences? Krasinski even went on to say that he doesn't know how he'll live with himself if the showrunners screw this up and ruin it for him. Well, unfortunately for Krasinski, the man in the waiting room was none other than the show's executive producer, Greg Daniels himself. Yikes. At least he still got the part, despite that whole tirade. But it's a good thing that he did, because after he landed the role of Jim Halpert, John Krasinski started interviewing paper company employees for research. Talk about committing to a role. The now 43-year-old actor spoke to several employees at different paper companies to research the role. During this time, he filmed one of his visits to Scranton, Pennsylvania. Now, the footage from this trip through the city actually ended up being used in the show's opening credits. Isn't that cool? Fellow cast member Rainn Wilson's memoir revealed that Krasinski also played a major role in helping production with set design and details. Now, the Office writers weren't the only ones pulling double duty on set. Phyllis Smith did too. In fact, she didn't audition for the role. Phyllis was a casting agent for the show before she got the part of, well, Phyllis. She was reading the script with some of the actors who were auditioning when director Ken Kwapis noticed her. It was then he decided that she should play the role. Fun fact, her character doesn't really exist in the British version, but the role was specifically created for Smith. But we guess the director thought she'd be a fantastic addition to the cast and offered her the role. Speaking of unexpected things on set, Mindy Kaling and BJ Novak were both hired to write for the Americanized version of the show when they were just 24 years old. Besides writing, they were also performing as Ryan Howard and Kelly Kapoor on the series. And over the next several years, we saw life and art imitate each other. Much like Ryan and Kelly, Novak and Kaling also started dating in real life back in 2004. Well, sort of. Novak says that no one, including them, ever really knew if what they were doing was dating. That's a weird take, but okay. He claims that whether it was dating or not, no one knew. But what they did know was that they'd always find themselves next to each other even when they weren't getting along. Sounds like marriage to me. Ultimately, they didn't really work out as a couple, neither in the show nor in real life, but they remain the very best of friends even today. Okay, that's kind of cute. One thing's for sure though, they did one heck of a job writing for the show. And perhaps one of the funniest examples of this is referenced in the finale of The Office. The show revealed that Creed Broughton was in a band called the Grassroots. Now, I can neither confirm nor deny that the band was actually involved in the lucrative trade of drugs as referenced in the show, but Creed really did play guitar and sang vocals for the band back in the 60s. Yep, he was a legitimate member of the band, which was also real. Broughton was a part of the Grassroots during some of their most successful days. In fact, they're still making music today, although unfortunately, Creed is no longer part of them. Yep, he left the band citing artistic differences. Broughton was really frustrated with the band refusing to make original music and only choosing to make covers instead. He left the band for a bit and eventually quit music altogether by 1969. 30 years later, he published his own solo album. Can you believe it? In 2001, Broughton enlisted the help of Peter White, a famous jazz guitarist, and decided to let his solo stuff from the 60s finally be heard. Better late than never, right? No one knows this sentiment better than Steve Carell. Where other actors had gotten major jumpstarts before him by acting in commercials as a kid, Stephen John Carell didn't get his acting debut until the age of 29 years old, when he landed a minor role in the film Curly Sue. If you ever happen to see the 1991 film, catching Carell in the few moments that he's on screen is kinda creepy. Then, only 29, he looks oddly similar to the way he's looked for the last 20 years. Insane. Can someone get the secret to his fountain of youth? And it wasn't until he was 43 years old that he made his debut as Michael Scott on The Office. But the best part is, Carell's talent doesn't just restrict itself to his portrayal of the company's manager. He also wrote what is easily known as the series' best episode from season 4, The Dinner Party. Man, I had tears running down my eyes watching that episode. I've never laughed this hard. Every single cast member was phenomenal as we saw their character dynamics clash across one single evening of chaos. Each scene was a perfect example of the kind of cringe humor that went on to define The Office. And while usually most episodes on the show stuck to the script, The Dinner Party had scenes that were mostly improvised by the actors. That includes Michael's incredibly emotional rant about getting multiple vasectomies, and Jan dancing while holding Jim's hand. According to the cast members who were at the dinner party, all of them claimed this was the hardest episode to shoot without ending up in laughing fits. Well, that's all for me on The Office. Things you didn't know about the cast members.
Who put my calculator in Jell-O? Or I'm gonna lose my freaking mind!
Hitting pot, it don't stop.
We should probably head on down, yeah.
And I could surprise you. Oh, no! I have to go to the bathroom.
That doesn't surprise me.
Yes! Yeah! Yeah! Okay! Yes! It's a Christmas miracle!
Beef. It works for dinner.
Who wants some man meat?
I do.
Okay, masters of comedy, a guy dropped his pants. Have you ever been to the circus?